This is a look at the floating point implementation on Plasma. I'll explain how it works and then run a demo program which is full of floating point calculations and is a fitting tribute to a classic program from the 60s. If you're not interested in the bits and bytes, this link will skip straight to the demo. The initial plan was to go for broke and implement a full 64-bit double precision system, but after several days of design and coding using the simulator, I fell at the last hurdle when it was loaded onto the MCU and it didn't work. It was then I found out that my build system needed an upgrade to support 64-bit floating point, Sod's Law. So rather than get bogged down with a major update to the build process and potentially screwing everything up, I decided to keep it simple and use 32-bit single precision instead. This actually turned out to be a better choice as the values don't hog so many registers, making it easier to program and visualise on the lights. So what's the point of floating point? The full gory details are on the internet, but the bottom line is they can be useful in certain cases, such as representing real numbers containing decimal points, like 3.14159, and for numbers with a much larger range than what we've been using up to now. There are many caveats and gotchas. There's no such thing as a free lunch, so some programmers steer well clear of these and use alternative techniques instead. But if you do want to use them, what do the 32 bits represent? Now, I'll use the assembler to help with this. It's quite a useful tool for experimenting. Now, here are a few numbers declared in the data section of the program. 1.375, 5.5, minus 5.5, and 4.0. And the rule is that if a number contains a decimal point, the assembler will treat it as a floating point value and encode it as such. So let's assemble the program, open the listing file, and you can see the floating point bit patterns in hex. And if you're new to this, you might want to refer back to an earlier video on hexadecimal values. The first number is hex 3FB00000, which is binary 0011 for the 3, 1111 for the F, 1011 for the B, and the rest are all trailing zeros, which we can ignore. These can be split into three fields. The first bit is a sign bit, the next 8 bits are the exponent, and the remaining 23 bits are the significand, sometimes called the fraction or mantissa. The actual name seems to depend on whether you're talking computers or mathematics, but either way it's the value which is raised to the power of the exponent. And of course, this being computer world, the exponent is a power of 2 as opposed to our more familiar power of 10. But the advantage from the computer's point of view is that powers of 2 are simply bit shifts left or right. The sign bit is self-explanatory, 0 for positive and 1 for negative, and it's even simpler than the 2's complement convention used with signed integral numbers, but it goes downhill from here. 8 bits in the exponent field give a range of 0 to 255, simple enough, but the exponent needs to handle positive and negative amounts, so it's biased around the midpoint, which is 127. This means a value of 127 represents a power of 0, 129 means a power of plus 2, and 125 is a power of minus 2. 127 is hex 7F, so this example needs no shifting. Okay, so far, what about the fractional part? Now, this is more fiddly, but basically it's a binary fraction with an implied 1 point before it. In this case, the binary value is 011, 0000, etc. And the rule is you just stick a 1 point in front of it to get 1.011, 0000, and then shift the point left or right, depending on the exponent. In this case, no shift is required, so 1.011 is the final answer in binary. So to convert to decimal, you treat the bits to the left of the point just like the binary patterns we've seen before. In other words, they represent from right to left 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, and so on, doubling each time. And if you travel to the right of the point, you guessed, the bits halve each time. So they represent a half, a quarter, an eighth, a sixteenth, and so on. And you just add all these together. In this case, we've got 1 to the left, so that's just 1. We've got 011 to the right, so that's no halves, 1 quarter, and 1 eighth, which makes 3 eighths. So the bit pattern represents 1 3/8, or 1.375. The next one is hex 40BO0000, which is this in binary. And splitting it up gives this. Again, the sign bit indicates a positive number. The exponent field this time is hex 81, which is decimal 129, so we need to shift two places to the right. The fraction is binary 011, followed by zeros, so we first write a 1 point in front of it to give 1.011, then shift the point two places to the right, giving 101.1. Now convert back to decimal. Moving from the point to the left, we have a 1, no 2s, and a 4, which makes 5. Moving to the right, we have a half, so the whole number is 5.5, or 5.5. The minus 5.5 value is hex COBO, which is just 40BO as before, but with the sign bit set to 1, so it's a negative number. I won't bother with the 4.0, but just make a note of the hex pattern, 4080, as there may be a test later. Now before moving on, I did find the Wikipedia article on 32-bit floating point was very difficult to follow, as it wandered all over the place. It seemed to be written by a different person than the article on 64-bit double precision, so I would recommend reading the 64-bit one instead. The principle is exactly the same, it just uses more bits for the exponent and fraction fields. Right, so how do you use them in a Plasma program? They're available in the Plex emulation, microcode 3, although as you've just seen, the Plasm assembler will let you plant floating point numbers in the data section for the toy emulations as well. So you could even have a crack at coding your own arithmetic routines using the toy instruction set if you fancy a challenge. A Plex had a few spare opcodes in its instruction set, so these are now used for basic floating point operations on the accumulator with inline literals, such as load a literal or multiply with a literal. A few trig functions are also available, sine, cos and tan, plus powers, square root and logs. Here's an example. Note the source code directive needs to be 3 for Plex. We'll load ACK with 1.375 and multiply it by 4. I'll run it through the assembler to get the machine code and enter the program on the switches. Obviously with a larger program you would get Plasm to create a paper tape file on an SD card which could then be physically loaded into the paper tape reader slot on Plasma. This has all been shown in previous videos. Here's the load ACK instruction. And if I single step it, you should recognise the literal 1.375 in the accumulator, 3FBO0000. Step again, and the accumulator has now been multiplied by 4, and hopefully the answer should be our old friend 5.5, 40BO0000. Right, there are many more functions, but these are implemented as extra codes. And this was a common technique for adding more functionality to an existing computer design, implemented either in hardware or microcoded routines. The Plex uses the SIS, or system opcode, for accessing extra codes. Its operand is a single word, called the function word, which, as you'd expect, defines the function and its parameters. As shown earlier, this technique is used for all the I/O functions and miscellaneous integer operations on the work registers and accumulator, so it was just a case of adding a few more to handle floating point. Most of the functions treat the 16-bit work registers as 32-bit pairs, R0 and 1, R2 and 3, and so on. This gives up to 7 pseudo-accumulators in addition to the real one. Here's an example using register pairs. The function parameters, in this case the source and destination register numbers, are ored into the function word at assembly time. So this is load registers 4 and 5 with 1.375, load R6 and 7 with 5.5, and divide the second by the first. When we run this later, the result will be in R6 and 7. Now here's the assembly listing file. If you're concerned about memory overhead with all these inlined function words, the SIS opcode can also get this from a register instead of memory. So this is handy if you want to reuse the same function multiple times. And if you do it this way, You can OR in different parameters to the function at runtime as opposed to assembly time. The parameter order follows the same convention as the opcode operands, which is destination first, then the source. So this loadIndirect function says load registers 4 and 5, the destination, with the memory location addressed by register 1, the source. I'll load it into the machine and step through it. Here's 1.375 on registers 4 and 5. Here's 5.5 on registers 6 and 7. And here's the result, 4. Did you recognise it? Okay, that's enough for now. All functions are in the latest documentation on the Filizan website. You can try them out using the PlasmaSim simulator, which now has options to decode the registers in floating point format, so it can be quite instructive while you get used to the bit patterns. Here's a quick example mimicking what we've just done on the real machine. Right, now for the demo. This was my original inspiration for implementing floating point, and it also turned out to be a useful test program. It's an old classic game from 1969 called Lunar Lander, or Rocket, which, although it seems very crude now, became very popular back then in the era of the Apollo moon landing, which had us all on the edge of our seats as it attempted to land. The program was written by a high school student to put you in the driving seat and choose when and how much reverse thrust to apply in order to slow down the lunar module sufficient for a soft landing. Bearing in mind only a limited amount of fuel was available, you still got to get back home, and all the while plummeting to the ground at thousands of miles an hour. Now, according to info on the web, the program was originally written for a PDP-8 mini computer in a language called Focal, which I've not heard of, but it's been converted to more popular languages over the years, some with added graphics and real-time operations, as opposed to the original's turn-based operation with simple text messages. There are links in the description if you're interested. This version for Plex was converted from a couple of text-based versions I found, one written in C and another in BASIC. The tricky parts to convert were the complex calculations, where the order of precedence is crucial. Here are a few extracts showing the floating point operations. Now, my code is just a literal copy. I've made no attempt to improve the efficiency, but then that wasn't the aim. I've changed a few messages and added a few delays for realism, so any apparent sluggishness is deliberate. Now, this one definitely needs a paper tape, so I'll get that punched. Now to load and run it. Well, as you can see, there's absolutely no point in me applying for the job. Maybe you can do better. Okay, that's it. Thanks for watching.